Well, good morning, everyone. And my presentation today, as you've probably seen, undoubtedly seen in the abstracts, is called "And Then the Magic Happens: What BAs Can Learn from the World of Magic." And I'm guessing that a few of you are sort of sitting there wondering, what on earth is this bloke going to talk about in 45 minutes? It might help if I explain that one of the things that fascinated me, that always fascinated me, is about the intersection between different disciplines. And if you think about business analysis, it would be very easy for us to draw these arbitrary walls around what we do and say, well, this is business analysis and this isn't. But actually, I think one thing that comes through really strongly from this and other conferences is those are permeable walls. And actually, it's more like a whole series of Venn diagrams. You've got business analysis mixing with user experience and customer experience and service science, and we learn more together. And a particular experience which I'll tell you about during this presentation got me interested or re-energized my interest in magic. And it led me to ask the question, could we learn anything from the world of magic? And it sounds so abstract, but hopefully my aim is by the end of the session to convince you that maybe we can. And as you will have seen from the abstract, I'm also going to try and do a couple of magic tricks along the way as well. But there's a caveat. I mean, with VAs, you have to have a caveat, right? I am not a magician. So I'm going to try two tricks. One is quite a small trick, one's a little bit of a bigger trick. There is a good chance that one or both of them might fail. So I have a favour to ask you. If you see a magic trick and it's even remotely worked, could you please give a round of applause? And if you see a magic trick and it's failed, once you've stopped laughing, could you also give a round of applause? It'll be great as well. Okay, but it's a bit of fun, you know, it's a bit of fun all the way. So, my presentation today, it's built around three of the BA questions that we ask a lot in our lives. They're not the only three BA questions, but built around why, what, and how. And I'm going to start by talking about why I got interested in magic. I'll tell you a bit of a story. One thing about this presentation is perhaps a little curveball, a little different. We may sort of zigzag around a little bit, and it's more sort of story-based. I'll talk about what interests me, but then I'm going to move on and talk about, okay, what techniques could we perhaps take from the world of magic, and what analysis techniques could we maybe put a magic lens on to look at differently? And there'll be a whistle-stop tour through some techniques. There's some that you will have seen before, some that are probably new to you unless you happen to be a magician. And this is based on some research I did. I managed to speak to a bunch of magicians, and it was a really interesting thing to do. So, starting with why. What crazy inspiration could lead someone to get on stage and talk about magic? Let's kill the slides for a minute. So I live in Portsmouth on the south coast of the UK. And about probably 18 months, 2 years ago, I was coming back from an IIBA event in London. And it was quite late, and the train's normally busy, but actually, it was pretty empty. I was at 10:30 from Waterloo to Portsmouth Harbour. And I was just suddenly aware, it was about the time we got to Guildford, if any of you know the route, that's about halfway between Portsmouth and London, I was just suddenly aware of this sound. And it was the sound of someone doing what I now know is called a rifle shuffle. For those of you that aren't familiar with what a rifle shuffle is, I can't do one, but you will have seen magicians and people who do cards do them. It's where a professional magician or card player takes the deck, they cut it, and they kind of rifle it together and manage to shuffle it that way. And I could just hear the sound and I was fascinated. And I broke the South Coast commuter rule. Is anyone here from the South of England? I kind of feel this. Okay. So in the south of England, there's this unspoken rule that you never speak to another human being on public transport. And it was probably because I had a beer at the IIBA event, or maybe more than one beer, but that's a separate story. But I had to go and ask, what's this guy doing? And he explained to me he's a magician, and he's doing all this stuff with cards. And I asked him those questions that probably every magician dreads to hear. Can you show me a trick? Basically, yes. And he was doing all this really cool stuff with cards. He was, he was predicting the cards that I was going to pick. And it was amazing. So he was showing me his art. He was showing me his discipline. And I said to him, where have you been? And he explained me to this magician's convention somewhere in, I think it was up in the north of England or wherever he was travelling home. And I said, you must have had a really good time there. You're clearly a really talented magician. And his whole physiology changed. His mouth dropped. He looked quite sad. And I was really confused. I said to him, well, you're clearly a good magician. Why are you unhappy? And he explained to me, he said, in the world of semi-professional and good amateur magic, it's almost like magicians have lost touch with the audience that they are there to serve. He said, if you take an average magic set that you would give any child, and many of us have got children, those magic tricks that you give them for Christmas, he said, actually, the principles in those, if you polish them over a number of years, you can wow an audience with, even though they're really simple. He went on to say that what magicians do, and in some parts of the magic community, they build more and more complex ways of delivering the same result, delivering the same illusion. And he said he always kept things simple, and that's frowned upon. Everyone's looking for a new way, a more complex way, a harder way of delivering the same result. He went on to tell me that if you're a professional or a semi-professional magician, you have to use bicycle-branded playing cards. Who are you? And you have to use Sharpie-branded marker pens. He said the irony is, bicycle-branded playing cards are actually too perfect to use for most card tricks. They're too glossy. You have to work them in. But that's what the magic community, or some parts of the magic community, were attending. And he used this phrase, and I guess like many videos, I always carry a notepad around me in my inside pocket, and I wrote this phrase down. He said to me, it is like we are focusing on doing magic for magicians. We've lost touch with the audience. We've lost touch with that wow we want to create for the audience. The reason I mention this is I had a bit of a penny drop moment because at the IIBA event, I'd been having a dialogue and debate with someone I know well, a very trusted colleague of mine, and we were talking about business analysis techniques. And we were talking about notations, and we were discussing whether, do you have to always use a really complex model with a formal semantic notation, or actually, sometimes, are post-it boxes and lines fine? And I was very much, boxes and lines are probably okay here a lot of the time. And the person I'm speaking to is saying, we always have to take it to a multi-layered semantic model. And I wonder, is there a danger? And I don't think we do get there. But is there a danger that if we carry on down that line, we could engage in analysis for analysts? That we could lose touch with our audience and the wow factor that they want to get from us? And I've got a bit of a confession to make here. I kind of feel like we're all friends because I'm 2.5 days now. Sometimes I zoom into Visio to make all the lines completely straight. And I know that each and every one of you has done that too. Do our audience, do the consumers really care? Sometimes they do, and sometimes it's important. But maybe sometimes it just needs to be good enough. So I want to talk about the reason I plant that seed is we need to pivot, avoid that analysis for analysts, keep connected to our audience to create the wow moments for them. But of course, it's more complex because we are often parachuted into what a construct that we often know as a project. And it's great on enough projects, but I'm sure many of us are parachuting in a little bit too late sometimes, if truth be told. And perhaps we're parachuted in the first thing that we're told is we've already chosen a solution. And perhaps we're also told something like the vendors lift and drop. If you ever have that, by the way, lift and drop, you can be pretty sure that project's going to consume the next 3 years of your life. Or then that's perhaps combined with, oh, we haven't allocated any budget anyway. Although from the previous keynote presentation, which I thought was awesome, maybe we don't need to allocate budget, maybe we measure things in a different way. And of course, oh, and we need it by like next month or next week or whatever. And it's like we're dealt this devilishly difficult deck of cards. And it almost feels like, to me, and maybe to you, it sometimes feels like what they're really saying is, okay, we've given you all these impossible constraints. Now go do some magic. Make the thing work. So this is where the sort of interest in magic came from. I had that chance encounter on a train, got talking to a magician, I had that penny drop moment, and I was drawing parallels with what we do as business analysts. So moving on to the what and the how can we potentially use tools, techniques in the world of magic in our own lives as business analysts? And it's sort of interesting, because I guess if you draw it down to the fundamentals, you think about what we do as BAs. Let me come back to my notepad. This is a blank notepad. I've been starting a new one recently. And if you think about when we start a project, it's like there's so much potential. There's blank potential. And our job is to define the value that our stakeholders want, and also to figure out the outcome that they want. And normally, part of that magic is to take that potential and convert that untapped potential into something like money. And conversely, what we're sometimes presented with is some budget. And if we're not careful, we end up delivering empty potential. Thank you. I always have to turn that back to paper, otherwise I'm fearful someone will spend it. Anyway, so talking about techniques, tricks that we can use as business analysts, I met and became very good friends with a particular magician who also spoke to other magicians. Actually, magicians are often very coy about their art, as you expect, but one person is really particularly open. And we sat down and talked about trick design. Because I always assumed that magicians go out and buy tricks. But he said, no, if you're a good amateur or even a semi-professional or professional magician, you make your own. You design them from scratch. And we sat down one summer's day over coffee, and we mapped out how they designed tricks, or how this particular magician made tricks. And again, I was sketchy, he's got a visual person. And we started, and it was really interesting. We said, you know what? You have to start by knowing your resources. If you're designing a trick, you need to know whether you're going to have access to an assistant. If you're designing a massive trick that's going to be on stage, you're probably going to need some set designers. But what was really interesting, he said, you need to start to think about the audience really, really early. And he said, you have to think about the audience, because the type of audience determines the type of trick and how you deliver that trick. He said, for example, if you're doing magic at a children's party, who's got some young children? And yeah, you'll probably identify with it. He said, if you're doing magic at a children's party, it's half crowd control. He said, if you are doing magic, close-up magic at a corporate do where people have a few drinks, that presents a different set of challenges. If you're doing on stage, that's a different set of challenges. But he said, the interesting thing is, most people in the audience will want your trick to succeed, but there will be some that are trying to disrupt you. And ironically, he said, do you know what? The worst audience are professional magicians, because they're trying to look for every single thought. He then went on to say, once you've done that, then you define the outcome or effect. So you know your audience, now you're saying, what outcome or effect do we need to create to wow that audience? So maybe we're going to make someone disappear. We're not going to do that today, by the way. I'm not that ambitious. Or maybe we're going to make something levitate or card trick or whatever. Then, he said, you need to know about the constraints of the environment where you're going to be performing the magic. So take this room, for example. You're all in front of me. Okay? That means I've got the ability to do stuff which I wouldn't be able to do if there were people to the side of me. Okay? If I was doing close-up magic, there would be a different set of constraints and different types of tricks. So you need to know the environment where you're performing the magic as well. Then we talked about trick design. And this varies with every trick, but a sort of common pattern we came up with is he said, once you define the effect, you go through this creative process of designing, building, iterating, testing. You test, you adapt, you polish it, until you're ready to perform it, then you perform it, and you actually deliver the value, the outcome, the effect to small members of that. So we were in a coffee shop somewhere, drawing this, and I was looking at it. And I was thinking, this looks really familiar. Because, right, if you took the word magic off of that, and called this a project, it's a lot like what we do, at a high level. So this led me to say, well, okay, well, maybe we can learn something from magicians by how they handle some of these things. And the first thing I was really interested to talk about is the constraints. Because I guess we deal with constraints every day in our daily lives, VAs. And so I asked, how do you deal with the constraints? When I started to talk to magicians about constraints, they talked about a card trick called the burglar's effect. And the burglar's effect is considered the holy grail of card tricks. It's also known as ACAAN, any card at any number. And there's a whole set of rules, kind of like business rules, actually, that define what is the burglar's effect. But I have no idea how it's done. No one will tell me. But if we were to do it, and we would have an unopened fair deck of cards, a volunteer from the audience would shuffle those cards. Another volunteer from the audience would choose any card at free will, so they might say ace of clubs. A third volunteer would give a number between 52, so they might say 37 or whatever. And then you would deal down the deck from 1 to 32, and it would be the card that's been predicted, the ace of clubs, whatever. Okay. The thing about that trick, if you think about it, it is impossible. You cannot, if it's truly fairly done, you cannot actually ever do that. So I said, well, how do people actually perform it? Because it's been performed thousands, if not tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of times. And the one magician I was speaking to a lot said, do you know what, Adrian? Although there are the constraints, you bend them. And he said, the thing is, audiences have an outcome that they want. They want to be wowed. And magic is about finding a constraint they care least about that you can bend. I thought that was a really interesting idea because when I hear the word constraints, what immediately springs to my mind is this. The iron triangle, the triple constraint of project management. There are other versions of it as well. And of course, there's the old adage, quick, cheap, fast, choose any one. But what we probably find is actually people are focusing on time, cost, scope, and quality suffered by default, because it's the only thing that can actually flex. It's probably not always okay. But what if we took a leaf from the world of magic and said, well, actually, if you understand the outcome, how about if we test how bendable some of these constraints are? We could wow our audience, but bend some of these constraints with little thought experiments. And you've got to have rapport with stakeholders to do this. But what about if we ask a thought experiment questions like, well, you know what? What about if it was 1 week later but half the cost? And we're not saying you can actually deliver that. But if someone said, oh gosh, well, yeah, of course, I mean, it was half the cost, then okay, well, maybe time is a bit variable then. Maybe it's not quite set in stone as we thought. Let's face it, you and I know most deadlines have been arbitrarily plucked out of the air. So let's nibble away at that and sign the truth constraints. Or we might ask scoping questions like, well, you know what? What if we deliver it incrementally and give you something sooner? You can actually start realising value sooner. A different way of nobbling away at those constraints. Or even, could we drop quality? And maybe getting something good enough out the door is the focus. So asking these little thought experiment questions, of course, in parallel with our project managers, like a dynamic duo, to really understand the value, the outcome that our audience want to be, to really wow them. But it's not just constraints at the project level. If we take that burden aspect and think about it in the context of business analysis, it's broader. And you can imagine it's like an onion, or you've got the layers going on. And we've got the triple constraint in the terms of our projects. But actually, the organisation will be throwing constraints, opportunities, threats at that project. You know, if the business unit head has made an announcement to the press that something's happening by quarter one, you can be pretty sure that we're going to have to make something happen by quarter one. But knowing that means we can provide options. We can enable our stakeholders to make really informed decisions. So that broader awareness piece is really key. And then the organisation as a whole will be putting the same or similar types of constraints on the business unit, on the project. And of course, in a wider world, there's the domain, there's the outside world. And a lot of the techniques that we don't have the opportunity to talk about right now, I'm sure many of us, or at least a few of us, are familiar with techniques like steeple, castle, step, whatever you call it, different versions, or horses, side horses. And those are the sorts of techniques that we might use that outer layer to say, what's pushing in our organisation? That's pushing in our projects, so we can really understand those constraints. So it's worth thinking about that. How do we bend? Which constraints are bendable and malleable? But then we're not talking about other parts of the trick design process. And we talked about defining the effect. And in magic terms, this is doing, what are you looking for? You know, are you looking to make someone disappear? Are you looking to appear psychic? What outcome, what effect are we looking for? And there's a quote, and unfortunately this isn't quite verbatim, so I couldn't write it down quickly enough. But the magician I was speaking to, got to know really well, said something along the lines of, it's not just the effect, what they see, it's also what they experience during the trick and the way they feel when the trick's over. The illusion, often that's the easy part, it's the artisan of the whole performance. Answers in the whole performance. And you think about that, it's like if you see magic on TV, it's not like someone comes on stage, does a trick, and then goes off stage. You know, there's smoke and magic and art and performance. But then think about projects. Actually, with a project, it's about more than just the change, it's also about how we get there. Architecting a project experience for our stakeholders so that they want to come back and use VA time and time and time again with their first port of call, their trusted advisors, as well as what is left after. So I'm going to talk about a couple of techniques. You will have seen, I'm sure, it was one of these techniques before, but a reminder, a refresher. Because how do we define the what's left after? What wow are our audience looking for? And a really useful tool is the balanced business scorecard. And I'm not talking about setting dogmatic KPIs or anything here, but if we know the problem or opportunity that our stakeholders are trying to achieve, the trick they're trying to perform, we can start to say, what would success look, feel, sound, smell like? And the traditional balanced business scorecard, which has been around a long time, we encourage us to think about critical success factors, so qualitative factors, and also the way we measure that from KPIs or quantitative factors. And you can apply this at a whole organizational level, but here we're talking about the almost the project level. And it's really great, we can start to think, okay, well, financially, what are we aiming for here? You know, are we looking for increased revenue? Are we looking to avoid costs? Are we looking for budget? Are we looking for something else? And knowing that, if we know that, we've got a fighting chance of aligning the project to achieve it. But then also, what do we need from a customer perspective? Are we looking for improved service, or just a sustained service, or something else? And how do we measure that? Is it through customer survey results or whatever? Then from an internal process perspective, what do we really need to excel at on once this project's finished? What will we need selling at? If we were Amazon.com and we're going to start selling magic tricks to magicians, maybe we need best-in-class logistics. And we need to measure that by how many magic tricks we can get out the door in a day, or whatever. And traditionally, in the original balanced business scorecard, this was learning and growth or innovation. And I've bent that slightly and called it sustain. And what this is in a project context is how do we ensure that that problem stays solved or that opportunity stays leveraged? And by defining these things, we're starting to define our outcome or the project outcome. And of course, all this stuff should be in the business space, but we can contribute to creating that crystal clear clarity so we can have a laser like focus on the outcome, the trick we're trying to perform. But the question is always outcome from whose perspective? There are many audience members, many stakeholders. And another technique that can be used alongside this is a nice little technique. It's lesser known, but a nice little technique called UCOP. Okay, UCOP stands for user, customer, owner, beneficiary. And the idea here is that, you know what, often services, products, systems, processes, whatever we're working with, they have a user. Somebody who's actually going to use the work with it or whatever. Often that's a different person from the economic customer, who's the person who's paying for that thing. That can often be a different person from the owner who is maintaining that thing, and that's often a very different person from the beneficiary who's actually benefiting from the thing. So that's like, I know that's terribly abstract, so to put a concrete example on it. Imagine a regional NHS trust procuring 15 new expensive hospital machines. Well, the economic customer is probably a procurement manager or a procurement team, and they're going to really value purchase costs, capital costs, and that's important. The user is going to be the doctor or nurse or medical professional that is probing the patient with this tool, and they're going to care more about ease of use. The owner is going to be the individual hospital that's going to have to maintain these machines, and they're going to care a lot about the running costs. Capital costs they might care less about. And the beneficiary, that's the poor patient being prodded, and they're going to care about how much it hurts. So all of these perspectives have to, you know, if we're going to create something that creates a wow for our audience, we need to think about the outcome from, yes, the traditional balanced business scorecard perspective, but also from the perspective of different stakeholders. And these are just four categories. You can create your own actor and so on. And you can imagine, and I'll show you a visualization of this in a second, if you have the four categories from the balanced business scorecard, you can create a matrix against these as a kind of checklist or a thought device. But then we can go beyond like traditional outcome and think about the project experience. And we can start to think, okay, if we're creating an outcome, we know what they want to achieve, we know the feeling they want to have after, but actually, what do we want them to see and hear during the project itself, during the change? What do we want them to feel? And how do we want this project experience to be remembered? Because if we deliver the right thing in the wrong way, it will probably still fail. I'll give you an example of this, okay? A slight tangent, but it'll be relevant, I promise. This is a picture of my garden. Now, a number of things you can immediately, you're probably now judging me. So the project that I always fail at is keeping plants alive. And so what you can see from this is I am a city dweller. Portsmouth is a fairly dense city. I travel a lot, so there's never really anyone around to water the plants. You'll also notice that there's some garden furniture here, which I very, you know, I like being in the garden when it's sunny. It's a south-facing garden that you plant in the city of summer. But there's a story behind that garden furniture. A couple of years ago, I ordered that from a national chain of retailers that has an online presence. And I paid to have it delivered on Saturday. And I got an email through. Oh, yeah, congratulations, Mr. Reed, your order's been accepted. It will be delivered between 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. on your chosen delivery day. So I thought, great, okay, good. I mean, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. quite a wide delivery slot, but okay. So I was up at 8 a.m. really waiting. The weather for the forecast was great. I thought maybe I had barbecue in my mind for the evening. Midday comes, I'm thinking, well, I really would have liked to use some of this day, but it's okay, we've got till 6. 3 p.m. comes, I'm starting to get restless. I suspect, particularly the males in the room will have this experience. It's like you become a bit of a man child. You're waiting for your parcel to be delivered. It's like that Christmas experience. 5:45 came, no delivery. 6 p.m., no delivery. 6:15, no delivery. I ring the call centre. The response from the call centre is, oh, yes, yes, I'm sorry to inform you, it never made it on the courier's van this morning. I can sense the outrage in the room about saying that. So I did what most British people would do in that circumstance. I took a deep breath. What I wanted to say, by the way, we're quite polite. What I wanted to say was, that sounds very much like a you problem. But anyway, I said, well, that's a real problem. Couldn't you have contacted me? To which they said, it's the courier, it's not to do with us, you need to contact them. At which point I started to have a very difficult conversation. Eventually it was delivered, I had to take a day off work on Monday. Right, the thing is, the product exceeds my expectations, right? The glass is really nice, really good glass, and it reflects the sun, it's beautiful, right? The chairs are actually far nicer, they're far more comfortable than they look. Okay, it exceeded my expectations, but I hate it. But I hate it because every time I sit on that chair and have a beer, it reminds me of the really poor way it was delivered. And there are processes and systems in your organisation, my organisation, every organisation, that the users hate because of the way they were delivered. I was speaking to a good friend of mine, who's a operations, he works at the operations end of a particular organisation, that said they had a new system rolled out, and the first time they knew about it was when a new icon appeared on their desktop. Like for real. And understandably, they never really adopted it. And the great thing is, as VA, we have plans within our remit to avoid those situations. We can make sure not only that the product is right, the way it's delivered is awesome, that we create that real wow factor. What we're talking about now is the smoke, it's the music, it's the ambience in a project environment. So taking those metrics, those tools I've already talked about, you bend them together into like a grid. You can imagine taking the balanced business scorecard and UCOR and comparing them against each other. There'll be some areas where this makes more sense than others. And I haven't got time right now to go into detail, but it's useful as like a thought process to think, okay, well, from a user's perspective, what are they looking for? Maybe they're there, maybe they do. Maybe there's a different viewpoint to what the economic customer wants. The beneficiary might want something different. So useful as a thought experiment. But you can take it further and say, okay, but what do we want them to see and hear during the project? How do we want them to feel? And what do we want them to remember? And this is the bit, I don't know, in your organisation, but in organisations I've worked with before, this bit of the bottom is often forgotten. It is so, so powerful. And if it's planned in advance, so, so simple. But by no means simplistic. And we could go into communication planning and a whole bunch of other stuff as well. So how do we elicit this stuff? The next technique from the world of magic, we'll talk about really briefly. If you want to know more about this, speak to me in the break. But I was always fascinated. I was fascinated by how people, magicians, appear psychic, or appear to be able to read minds. And this isn't a value judgment about whether there are real psychics or not. I have no idea, but I do know that some magicians have ways of appearing to read minds. If you've seen Darren Brown, for example, you know he's really, really good. He's an exceptional example of that. One technique is a technique known as cold reading. And cold reading is a way magicians, or some magicians, use to appear to be able to read minds. There's a whole body of published work on this, and it's fascinating. And there are different linguistic patterns that magicians use. So one is known as the Barnum statement. And the Barnum statement is something that is, it sounds very specific, but it's actually very, very broad. And they're very normally artfully created. So it might be something like, I sense you're an independent thinker, and you sometimes just don't accept what the crowd is telling you. That sounds really specific, but I bet most of us would identify with that. So you say yes, and then you probably disclose some information. There are also what we call fuzzy facts. These are again apparently factual statements, but are again broader than they sound. So if we're in the US, we might say something like, I sense the connection with Europe. I can't quite tell whether it's the UK or the warmer Mediterranean part. You sound very specific, they get quite broad, and they might say, oh, could it be Scotland? Yes, that's exactly what I was envisioning. There's the veiled question, where someone will say something that sounds like insertion, it's actually a question in disguise. An example of this might be something along the lines of, I'm sensing a connection to travel, either now, in the past, or in the future. Does that make sense? At which point someone might say, well, yeah, I traveled 2 years ago. Yes, that's right. And finally, there's greener grass. And this is a really fascinating one, and it links back to the human condition I think we all have, that we sometimes wonder what would have happened if we'd taken a different path in life. So if you took a business degree, there's probably a part of you that wonders, what if I went on that year out with that person that I was dating at the time and took an arts degree, what would my life be like then? And there's that human fascination with that. So anyway, the reason that these are quite interesting from a BA perspective is, one, we should probably never ever fall into using these linguistic patterns, even unconsciously. It's really easy to lead the witness. We've all done it. We've all done it, particularly when time is short. But you can start to flip them, play with them, reverse them. Because, you know, if we're asking lots and lots of questions, then maybe rather than sounding like an interrogation, we can kind of broaden it out, veil it a bit. Say, oh, you know, I'm sensing there's some sort of problem with the invoicing process. Can you elaborate on that? Starting broad doesn't feel quite so pointed. Now, we might even use general Barnum statements and then cone in. And green grass, incidentally, I think is something we probably all do without even thinking about it. For example, by saying, what would success look like? But we can think broader, what would it sound like? It would involve more of the representation system. Again, another technique, unfortunately, I don't have time to talk about today, but speak to me if you're interested in it. There's a set of techniques called appreciative inquiry. And appreciative inquiry starts with the premise that you can actually start by forgetting what's there and say, if this whole mess wasn't there, how would we have created it? Which is an interesting, it's not always going to be the right or the most appropriate technique, but it's useful. Can be useful. Okay, so we talked about defining our effect, we talked about the constraints, bending those constraints. Very briefly before I close, I want to talk about designing, building, and testing a trick. And this was really interesting. What magicians told me is that if you've got a particular illusion you want to create, there is always, always more than one way of creating that illusion. And by the time I was doing this research, I'd become really good friends with one particular magician. And I actually got him to tell me how you can make someone disappear. Now, I'm not going to attempt to do that, but he said, as far as he knew, there were three main ways. And you've probably all seen this magician comes on stage, assistant gets into a box, the doors are open, and they disappear. And he used an acronym, which immediately resonated with me, because as BAs love our acronyms, or something I love acronyms, he said, P-E-R. If you want to make something vanish, you can either prevent, embrace, or rectify. I have no idea how widespread this acronym is in magical, whether it's one magician's thinking. But he said, you know, if you imagine that there is a box, you're inviting the assistant to get in the box, you can prevent them from getting in the box in the first place by they actually go around back in the trap door or whatever. You can embrace it. Maybe they drop some steps into the box, the doors are closed, and there's a trap door, and they're actually in the steps, and they're there all along. Or you can rectify it. They can get out the back, go down another trap door, or whatever. And the point here is that actually there are always, or often, many, many ways of solving the problems, delivering projects, that we work with. And actually, how often do our stakeholders think beyond the initial idea that they've had? Probably not an awful lot. So one of the key areas we can add real value to create that audience wow with our stakeholders is to help them imagine multiple possible solutions. And there's a whole bunch of techniques we could use out there that I'm sure we're aware of. Finally, very, very quickly, I do want to finish on a trick. Every magician I spoke to talks about audiences. And they talked about saboteurs, they talked about audience management, and they talked about saboteurs. And they said sometimes you get a winning saboteur who wants to unravel your trick. And he said sometimes they're overt and you know about them, sometimes they're subtle. And I asked, what do you do? And the response really surprised me. You get them on the stage. Because they are far less of a risk when you can see and manage them. And also, by getting them on the stage, they feel part of what you're creating. They feel part of what we're creating. Think about our saboteurs. If we shine into the spotlight, we should throw them some love, bring them on our stage. Because this is now, this is kind of like a stage. Maybe we can create that illusion that they're really wanting. Okay, so we've talked about it in summary, we talked about the constraints, bending the constraints of those thought experiments, time, cost, budget, which one can bend, let's really find out. We talked about defining the outcome and effect with a balanced business scorecard, not in a dogmatic KPI way, but in a really enlightening way, enhancing that with UCorp, and then going outcome plus with our what you see, hear, feel, and so on. Maybe even using a flipping cold reading, flipping that over to get some different elicitation. We talked about getting the disruptive members of the audience on stage. But remember, it's all in the performance. And the constraint that we are probably all familiar with is gravity. By the way, if there was a magic word in this analysis, what would that word be? Come on, someone must have an idea. What would the magic analysis word be? Say again?
Maybe.
Maybe? Okay, so maybe is our magic word. So, the venue has kindly provided me with this rather nice table here, and you'll see. It's a fairly standard table of cookies that are made of chipboard or whatever. So, gravity is a constraint. Constraint we all have. Now, what I'd like you to do in just a second is sort of chant the word maybe in a slightly mystical, mythical way. And remember, this might not work, but could you chant the magic word for me?
Maybe.
Yeah, keep going.
Maybe.
Okay. I now want you to chant project manager. Oh, it's getting angry, it's getting angry. I'm going to have to do these things get very dangerous. So, and the point behind that, of course, is that a good VA backed up with a project manager can achieve more together. Okay, they say in magic always leave them wanting more, so I'm not going to jump the shark and try and do more magic here. In our world, actually, let's leave them wanting more analysis. Let's want them coming back with their first point of call. We've architected such an awesome project experience that there is no question they come to us before there's even a project. We convince our skeptics, we avoid that analysis paralysis, we convince our skeptics. And if we do that, that intersection between magic and business analysis, maybe we look at intersections between other disciplines and our own, what other types of outcomes could we generate for our stakeholders? And with that, I will say thank you.